sometimes in life, you've just got to enjoy the little things, like playing with a glittery remote control poop. And you might be wondering, why am I playing with a glittery remote control poop? Well, I'm a software engineer, and sometimes I've been finding software kind of boring, which brings me back to this poop. I mean, why write code for things that exist in the cloud when we have remote control poops? That is way more fun. And if you look inside the poop, you'll find this circuit board, which is a microcontroller that probably has code on it that detects input from this remote and then triggers the motor, making the poop go vroom. Welcome to the world of physical computing, baby. Now, I've got to admit, I haven't actually figured out how to make my own remote control poop yet. But I have learned how to use this Raspberry Pi Pico, which is an affordable beginner-friendly microcontroller, to make my own RGB party lights device, where I can turn a knob to change the speed and press a button to toggle between different light modes. And I can't remember the last time I've had this much fun programming. So if you're a developer and have never tried programming for physical computing, you need to give this a go. And even if you're not a developer, this book is super beginner friendly. You don't need to know how to code or do any electronics things to get started. I've also vlogged most of my journey so far learning how to use the Raspberry Pi Pico. So keep watching to hopefully learn from my mistakes and maybe get inspired to do your own projects. So the first project I tried caused me a lot of grief. I managed to get the traffic lights to work where they went from green to yellow to red, but clicking the button that's supposed to trigger this buzzer was not doing anything. It was frustrating. Uh-oh. So I realized that I haven't been pushing the Pico down far enough into the breadboard as I could, but then I did that, but I accidentally put it in the wrong holes. So I went to take it out, but it was jammed in really hard. So it was really hard to take it out. And I've slightly bent some pins. I feel like it doesn't look that bad in the camera as it does in real life. I suppose it's maybe fixable. I'm just gonna try to jam it back into the breadboard in the right position and hope that it kind of fixes itself. These are really cheap, right? Oh my God, it's upside down. Okay, sanity check, team. Does that look like it's in the right holes?
1, 2, 3.
Yeah, nice. Okay guys, I figured out my problem. I'm pretty sure I just didn't have the button stuck deep enough into the breadboard. I guess this just comes back to being too scared and too much of a pussy to go the whole way with these things. Don't take that out of context. Now to finish this traffic lights project thingy-majig. Could you hear that?
Oh my God.
Press the push button switch. If the program is currently in the middle of its loop, nothing will happen until it reaches the end and loops back again. At which point, the light will go red and the buzzer will beep to let you know it's safe to cross the road. So, last night, I feel like I spent probably an hour pulling apart and redoing my little traffic light controller project, debugging it, trying to figure out why the frickin' button wasn't working. You know what? There was nothing wrong with my electronics. My brain. It was working as intended. I was clicking the button, expecting it to do something. But this code is designed so that it detects a button click, but it only does something if it's the right moment. Like it's a red light and, you know, you're crossing the road. You know what I mean? And I feel a bit stupid about it because I realized yesterday that was my problem when I was reading over the code. I'm just using 2 inches of my brain cells. Because, you know, I work as a software engineer. I have history doing programming things. This should be straightforward. Actually reading the code, I was like, well, duh. It's got LED red value 1, sleep 5 seconds, sleep 2 seconds, sleep 5 seconds, blah, 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 blah. During all of that sequential logic, it's not going to be executing my little buzzer from the button. And the reason I didn't pick up on it is because I guess I'm cocky. I have an ego. I'm confident, overly zealous. And in following these projects, I'm here to learn about all the electronics things. I'm like, I already know programming. I don't need to read about it. It's like, I don't read the text, you know, I'm just copying, putting in, plugging things into things, but I'm not really reading all the blurbs. I'm just skipping through. I feel stupid that I was stuck on that for so long. And if I just looked at the code, I would have figured it out. Anyways, round two. Ow. I'm sick of traffic lights. Let's try some different things. I feel like I'm an expert at this point. Okay, now I'm gonna try burglar alarm project, except I don't have a PIR sensor, but I do have, it's called a mini photocell. And upon Googling what that is, it detects light. So it's used for knowing whether the room lights have turned on or off, or the sun has gone down and automatically doing something. But as far as I can tell, I've skimmed through this whole book and nothing in this book actually uses a photocell, but they use a PIR sensor, which is like a motion detector thing. And the electronics kit that I got did not come with a PIR sensor, but it came with a photocell. So I'm like, do you reckon they're interchangeable? Surely I could kind of just use it in place of a PIR sensor just for the sake of learning how to do things and just learning how it works. Even though it's not really gonna be a very good motion detector, it's a light detector. They'll know if the people rubbing me are turning the lights on. Welcome to my desk. Do we reckon it's safe to assume that programming for talking to a photocell is probably pretty similar to what we do for a PIR sensor. Because, I mean, they're both just detecting something and then giving a response if they detected the thing. You know, motion, light, same, same. I'm going to assume it's fine. I'm just going to copy the code that they're using, even though it's not quite what I have. For anyone watching along at home who happens to also be a new big dummy, big time like me, they come with these fancy diagrams, which are to help give you some guidance on where to plug the things in. Because you can't just plug them in anywhere. Who would have thought? Wait, now I'm doubting myself. Maybe I should Google about the photocell thing. Okay, I'm gonna Google it. I don't want to fry my electronics because I'm plugging them into the wrong things and giving them too much power. Googling things is a good skill to have in life, right? Okay, for reference, everyone, this is the kit I bought. It's from raspberry.piaustralia.com.au. And it came with 1x mini photocell. Mini photocell. As the squiggly face is exposed to more light, the resistance goes down. To use, connect one side of the photocell, either one, it's symmetric. We like that. To power. For example, so this is ground. Let's now copy paste the code that they give us for this. Oh, I clicked run and it's not doing anything. It runs and then stops straight away. Okay, maybe I shouldn't have just assumed it would be the same as the PIR sensor logic. I gotta use my special 10K resistor. 10K ohms. Ohms. Side note, did you know that this is magnetic? This buzzer thing, the resistors stick to it. And we spent a long time last night looking for one of my resistors because I was convinced I lost it and one of the dogs have eaten it or something. It was just underneath this. Anyways, let's try that again. The diagram I'm looking at is for an Arduino, but surely the logic around it is the same. Tell me if that's flawed thinking. Will you work now? This is what I get for trying to go do something beyond what's in the book, but I suppose that's what happens when you want to do your own projects anyways. The code isn't doing anything. Did I do the right code? Note to self, click save on your file before you run it, even though it's still not working, but. Mini photocell input MicroPython. Okay, let's copy what this guy's doing. I was obviously doing something very wrong. Oh, that's working. Wow. Nothing very exciting, no, but numbers are showing up on the screen, and if I cover it, they change, I guess? Kinda? What if I turn all the lights off? I need to get a better tripod. You watch to let me know how the numbers change. I'll go turn lights off. 6,000, 62,000, and if I put the big light on, 5,000, 56,000. I guess the number changed a little bit. 41,000, 38,000. Oh, what if I shine my phone flashlight at it? Ba-dun. Hell yeah, 1,000. Look at that. Wow. And if I take it away, whoa, 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 incredible. Let's see if we can actually finish this burglar alarmy thing. And by burglar alarm, I mean, I'm not gonna even bother connecting the buzzer because we've established that the sound it makes is so quiet that it's just really sad. I'll just make a light flash. This is a proof of concept. We love those, right? How hard can it be? Famous last words. Oh, almost forgot to give my little lighty boy a resistor. Come on, have we not learned anything? Okay, my GitHub Copilot AI knew which GPIO number I needed. They're watching me. This code autocomplete autosuggest is getting too creepy. First it was my Instagram ads and my Google internet browsing, now it's my code? Okay, so I can't even copy this code anyways because it's for a different sensor. We have to use our own brain here. We've established the numbers range from like the low thousands up to what, 50, 60,000? So I suppose we just do, if the number is less than 25,000, I don't know, somewhere in the middle, make the light bulb go on, otherwise make it go off. Seems easy enough, right? Well, that was easy. Welcome to my show and tell. Oh, it's flashing from the light on top of my camera. Wait, I'll just turn you off. Okay, wow, it detects light, amazing. Okay, look, I gotta admit, it's not really the best burglar alarm. Maybe the project I ended up making is not quite the original project I set out to achieve. But you know what, this was more satisfying than anything I've done so far because it involved Googling things and kind of figuring it out myself, which I guess is more exciting than just following a guide straight up. Big brain. She's learning. You know what's next? We're gonna learn how to use a potentiometer. It's a variable resistor. I think this is it. It's a little blue knob with three little thingies sticking out of it and you can spin it or twist it. You know, like when you're controlling the volume on a device. What else do you spin? Your aircon in the car? Anyways, maybe I'll just go back to time-lapsing myself for this one. It's exhausting talking. Wow, look what I can do. So this is a potentiometer. Oh, okay. So this thing here, little potentiometer knob. And if I twist it, can you tell? It's fading and unfading the light. Woo! So rather than on off, it's a fade. Hell yeah, she's doing it. Wow. Oh my god, I was on such a roll and now it's been 2 weeks and I haven't done anything else. And I think I know why. I did a bit of playing around without vlogging offline in my alone time, my me time, messing around with whatever's going on here, and I broke a button. And to be honest, broke is a very dramatic word. You see, this thing is meant to have 4 legs and now it has 3. And to be honest, maybe it's not even that broken. Maybe it's still functional. I was looking at some diagram thing online and I'm like, maybe it can still work in a particular orientation. But alas, let's not ruminate over here. Let's get on with one last project I'd like to try. And for this one, we're not just following a guide from the book. This thing here is called a lorikeet something something something. And it's some programmable RGB lights. I don't know if you noticed, but I'm a fan of the RGBs. And I found a guide online on how to program this, and then I want to combine it with some of the other things I've learned so far from my little book and make some little RGB dance party lights device project. Undecided exactly what it'll look like, it depends what I'm actually capable of doing. Anything is possible, you've just got to believe. And then if I do this, I'm basically a pro, I can do anything. Maybe. Okay, time to lock in. Nothing's happening!
Yay! Woo!
Okay, so I'm whispering because it's after midnight. Shh. Now we're at the point of putting all the things we've learnt together and experimenting. First off, I'm gonna see if I can possibly connect my kind of broken button to this. I guess see whether the button even still works and then try to do some programming between the button and the lights. How hard can it be? One broken button. I've written some code to connect my button. Let's see if this works. Resource temporarily unavailable. Interesting. I ran my code and it lit up straight away, but I thought I coded it to start lighting up after I pressed the button. Yay! Oh. Well, button worked once and it's printing to the terminal, party mode activated with like 10 exclamation marks. But clearly it's not activated. Good night, Kiwi. Woo! And here's my final project. Well, a sad variation. Oh, it turned off. Uh-oh. The fact that it did just turn off, though, is a bit concerning. There might be a problem in my code. Anyways, speaking of, I worked on this quite a bit after the last footage that you just saw. Implementing like 4 different light modes and then using the knob to change the speed took me way more hours than I thought it would to code and get to work. I started off trying to make the code nice and fancy. I was trying to do multi-threading where you have 2 different pieces of code being able to run at the same time. And it just was not happening. I think after a few hours, I had to give up trying to be really fancy with my code and just write something that worked. And that's where this beauty came along. One big block of code with a lot of if-else statements. Nothing wrong with it, nothing wrong with it. It's just maybe not the best practice in terms of code quality, but it worked. And all the clips at the beginning of the video of my little project was using that code. And I was on a mission today to refactor and improve that code before sharing it with the internet because I was a bit embarrassed by it, to be honest. And since I had a version of code working, I could now iterate from that to make a better one. However, we hit a little problem. I don't know if you noticed, but there used to be a button here. You see, the point of my project was click button, toggle lights, move knob to change speeds, yada yada yada. Woo! My button has disappeared, gone into the abyss of the crevices of my household. Probably eaten by a dog or in the bin, who knows? But the button is mysteriously gone. We have a button thief. My burglar alarm from earlier was not good enough, apparently. Anyways, I decided, you know what? I can still write my improved, fancier version of my code, just with the knob instead of the button to change the light modes. And you can't change the speeds now, it's just one speed. The first mode is off, second mode is color wave, the third mode is smooth rainbow, the fourth mode is called fireflies, and the last one I'm just calling blue strobe, because I mean, what else? Here's my new and improved code with the fancier logic with different classes for all the different light modes. But I'll put links and details to where I got snippets of code from. Most of the code for all the different light modes came from other sources and I just kind of copy-pasted all these things together. So it's not all me, I can't take credit for all of it. Okay, so what? I know, it's not quite a poop. But you gotta admit, it's pretty freaking fun writing code for things that interact with things in the real world. It's just so much more satisfying. And I am one step closer to developing the skills to make the remote control poop of my dreams. So if you're a developer, you should try this too. And if you're not a developer, you can learn. Everyone's got to start somewhere. Anyways, that is the conclusion of my video, learning how to use a Raspberry Pi Pico, aka the more clickbaited title, every developer should try this. Please like and subscribe. And if you enjoyed this, there is going to be so much more content where this came from. Oh, I almost forgot. Like this box I got in the mail with more electronics components, but you'll have to subscribe to watch my next video to figure out what the heck I'm going to be doing. So thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.
And don't forget to enjoy the little things.